So you think two-factor authentication is bulletproof? Here's why you're still wrong. Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. To start with, I encourage you to use two-factor authentication. I know that the title might seem like it's not everything it's cracked up to be. It is. If you've got it turned on, it's one of the most important ways you can protect accounts from being hacked. As I've said many times, even if a hacker knows your password, with 2FA in place, they can't get in. But I've also said there's no such thing as perfect security. And that means that 2FA is not an excuse to ignore or deprioritize your security. Let's look at what two-factor authentication is and what risks you're still exposed to, even with it in place. First, a refresher. Traditional authentication requires something you know. Your password. That's a single thing. That's a single factor. Two-factor adds something you have. When you sign in and two-factor kicks in, it asks you to prove you are in possession of your second factor. That can take several forms, depending on what you have and what service you're signing into supports. It could be a smartphone in your possession, typically using an authenticator app, or an SMS-capable phone in your possession, or an email account you have access to, or another device on which you can respond to a confirmation message, or even, in a few cases, a landline phone you can answer. There are two common threads. All of these need to be set up prior to use, much like your recovery information. And typically, they actually only need to be used once, the first time you sign into a device you haven't signed into before. Now, regardless of all of the risks I'm about to list, I still want you to remember, any two-factor authentication is more secure than no two-factor authentication at all. Okay, risk number one, phishing. You get an email from your service with urgent information about your account. You're asked to sign in by clicking on a link in that email. You sign in normally, providing your username and your password, and a two-factor prompt comes up. You dutifully type in the code. You've just handed your account over to a hacker. What really happened is that the account sign-in page was fake, made to look exactly like what you expected. When you signed in, a hacker at the other end captured your username and your password and your two-factor code in real time as you typed it in. Again, in real time, they then turn around and immediately sign in to the actual account as you, change the password, remove two-factor authentication, and they now have control. The solution is the same for any phishing. Be skeptical. Don't click on links in email that you aren't 100% certain of. In the scenario above, rather than clicking on the link in the email, go to your browser and visit the site in question by typing in the URL you know is correct, or using a bookmark that you've set up previously. Once there, chances are the urgent issue, it'll be nowhere to be found, because it was never real. Risk number two, SIM swapping. This applies only to two-factor authentication techniques that rely on SMS text messaging and automated voice messaging to your mobile phone. What happens is a hacker contacts your mobile carrier with enough information to successfully impersonate you. They claim that you've gotten a new phone and need your phone number switched to that new device. It's not your new phone, of course, but the hacker's. If they are successful, the hacker will then start to get any two-factor authentication codes that are sent to your phone number. Remember, two-factor codes are sent to your phone number, not to your phone. What that means is it doesn't matter what phone is associated with that number, it's that phone, that number, that's going to get the message. Mobile providers, yeah, they're increasingly aware of this scam, and they certainly take steps to minimize the possibility. The problem, of course, is that they can't know when you've honestly gotten a new phone and need to change your number. They do their best, to prove that the person asking for the change is you through a variety of authentication mechanisms. But sometimes, hackers just have enough of your personal information to successfully fool a customer service agent. As you can see, you almost have to be targeted for this technique to work. Someone will have had to accumulate information about you that they could then use. The best defense? Two things. One, pay close attention to every notification you get via any channel from your mobile provider. If you get a "your number successfully been changed" notification, call them immediately. And many mobile providers now allow you to set up an additional authentication PIN unique to your account. Do that. Risk number three, malware. As I've said before, malware can do anything. So if you have malware on your machine and you use that machine to sign into an account, the malware could monitor the entire conversation. If a two-factor code is involved, the malware could report this to the hacker in real time. Much like the phishing scenario above, the hacker could immediately sign in as you, enter the two-factor code, and then change all the information about your account. It sounds trite, and I'm really not trying to be condescending at all, but the best defense here is not to allow malware on your machine to begin with. That means keeping your security software running and up to date, keeping all of your software as current as possible, including both the operating system and your applications. And since email attachments are one of the most common ways to deliver malware these days, don't open any attachment you aren't 100% certain is legit. Risk number four, backup codes. Most services that implement two-factor authentication have you create a set of backup codes that you can use in place of the second factor to get into your account should you ever lose the second factor. You should keep those codes somewhere safe, of course, in case you ever need them. That could mean in an encrypted file somewhere or printed out and stored in a safe place, including perhaps an actual safe. The risk is simply that these codes could fall into the wrong hands. Those hands would need to be connected to someone with more information about your account, like your user ID and your password, but with the backup codes, they can bypass two-factor authentication completely. The solution is to keep those codes somewhere secure. Risk number five, my method of saving QR codes. This is something I use to back up my two-factor authentication devices. When I set up Google Authenticator compatible two-factor authentication on a new account, I take a screenshot of the QR code used to set up my device. And for those that can't scan a QR code, there's usually a text representation of that code that's also usually available. Save that as well. I do this because if I ever want to add a two-factor authentication device, all I really need to do is scan or enter the code that I saved, and the new device immediately starts displaying the same codes as my original device. Now, yes, a hacker could do that too. If they get their hands on what I've saved, they could set up their own two-factor device to be a kind of clone of mine. The solution? Once again, keep those codes secure. In fact, keep them just as secure as the backup codes from the previous point. In my case, I use my password manager. Bottom line, again, use two-factor authentication. Any two-factor is better than no two-factor. But remember that perfect security doesn't exist, and you should never let your guard down. For updates, for comments, for links related to this topic and more, visit askleo.com/175611. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.